Hi, welcome along. Thank you for watching. I'm Keith Rozelle, sales marvel. Had a long career in corporate sales, corporate business-to-business sales, and some B2C as well, latterly. And what we're going to be talking about on this video is the learnings that I've had from a long career of organizing some really key client meetings, where they're are a number of people from each side attending. And the theme of this particular video is, how do you control those meetings? How do you avoid them getting way out of hand? How do you keep people focused so that you achieve exactly what you need to achieve from having that meeting? How do we do that? Okay, right. So as I said, a 30-year career in corporate sales. I'm a sales trainer now. I'm also a visiting lecturer with Aston Business School in professional selling. And this webinar is now a weekly event. Let's press on. So where are you in the sales process? Well, if you're having a big meeting, and by a big meeting, 4+ people from your company and probably a similar number, maybe more from their company, from your client, potential client, where are you in the sales process? Well, probably you're not at the very beginning of the sales process, otherwise they wouldn't waste their resources and you certainly shouldn't waste your resources. You're probably getting towards the end of the sales campaign where you've qualified the deal, you've spoken to some really important people, and this is a coming together of both parties to really flesh out, are we going to be able to do a deal here? Does it make sense? Can we agree acceptable terms to all the parties, to both parties? So you're probably somewhere near the negotiate or closing stage, towards the end of the stages of that particular sales campaign. And by definition of and context of a big meeting, probably 4+ people from your company, and probably a similar number, maybe more, from their company. You need to achieve an important outcome for your company. That'll be the thrust, that'll be the objective of why you're having the meeting. And there could be significant downside if the meeting goes against you, if it goes the wrong way. So it's that's what is important. You don't want any downside. You want to absolutely capitalize on all the effort that you've invested in that client, in that particular sales campaign. You want to capitalize on that. And the importance, by the way, it's not necessarily the size or complexity of the deal that you're talking about. It's just important, and important as defined by you and your company. So that could be many different things to many different people. So as an example, what could possibly go wrong is I didn't know who was attending. This is some of the feedback I've got from clients over the years, from informal feedback of meetings. And that takes a bit of courage to talk to people, get feedback, individual feedback on how did you feel about that meeting. So here's some feedback that I've got. Number one, I didn't know who was attending. That's sales 101. Should never be in that position. Number two, I didn't know who was doing what role in that room. And number three, I didn't know who to look at next. Now, on an individual basis, each of those are epic fails when it comes to sales, managing expectations, working with people around the table. But what, all three of those came from the same person. And that person was the chief financial officer of a FTSE 100 organization. That is not great feedback. So Andy didn't know who was attending. The message hadn't got to him from his assistant as to who was attending. So that was my fault. I was the salesperson on the spot, so he was not informed. I didn't ensure that went through. They didn't know who, therefore, who who was doing what role, and they didn't know who to look at next. There was no structure or flow for them. Those are all key learnings that I've got. And just before you wonder, we actually did go on to secure a really big deal from that client because of the remedy work, because of the feedback that I'd got from this client. They were open enough, and I think they also had an appetite, an agenda where they wanted us to succeed in this really big account, the FTSE 100 account. So that was the feedback. And I went back and I learned from that. And some of those learnings, many of those learnings and more, are on this video. Okay, brilliant. So what's next? So your role as the salesperson in a big or important client meeting where there are a number of people involved is to conduct the orchestra. So if you think about the role of an orchestra conductor, they're not playing an instrument. They are stood up at the front. They are the focal point for that orchestra. And you are literally conducting that orchestra, the wind section, the brass, the strings, percussion, all of those, and we'll talk about the individual roles and positions in a second. You are conducting those, and you need the best out of each section of that orchestra in order to achieve a successful outcome, whatever outcome that is that you've defined that you want to achieve. Your role is also not just conducting the orchestra, that's the overall, that's the corporate role, if you like, you're performing in that moment. You also need your team to land your sales messages effectively, and you're delivering those messages through the people that are attending on your behalf at that meeting, your colleagues, in other words. You need to make sure, and it's your responsibility, to ensure that the meeting objectives are met. And if they're not met, then it's your responsibility to determine why they weren't met. Okay, so let's assume that your responsibility is to make sure the meeting achieves its objective. And you also, you can learn lots from conducting the orchestra. You're taking an active part, but it's a quiet part at the same time. You may not say almost anything in the meeting itself. You may simply be guiding, literally conducting the orchestra. Remember, an orchestra conductor doesn't play an instrument. They lead the orchestra. So one of the learnings that you can get, and probably the most significant one, is that to work out who the most important player is around the table from the client. Who's the most important? Who's the most powerful? And it's not always the most senior person. So if you're there with the client's CEO or with the client's chief information officer, if it's a technology related deal, the most important person may not be the CIO. It may be their subject matter expert, whoever that may be. So that's your responsibility, is to look, learn, observe, understand, comprehend, and build from that. So also understand that less is more. Why are they there? I.e. justify each of the roles of the people around the table from your company. No passengers. We don't want any passengers. And think carefully about inviting people just in case. Because less is more. The more people that you have in your meeting, the more can go wrong, and the you dilute the power, influence, and effect that the other people have from your company around the table. Okay, so it defocuses everything that's going on. Okay, so I've got an example of a real life meeting that went on. I can pick from many, many meetings, but I've contextualized this just for accuracy. And the example preparation that I've got is, what's the objective? And you need everyone from your team, be it four people or be it 40, to be absolutely, you should never go to a meeting with 40 people, by the way, I just picked that number. So what's the objective? You all need to be aligned. Alignment is the hallmark of all good meetings. you're lined up around a particular objective. You're really focused, everyone's briefed. I'm also going to talk about best possible result, a minimum acceptable result. What do you want the client to say, do, or agree as a result of your having that meeting? You want them to agree that you're the best vendor, that you're the best supplier for that particular deal. You want them to implement contractual terms, get their lawyers into a place. What is it you're focused on doing? And also with the people that you're taking with you to that meeting, what position are they playing and what are their responsibilities? So everyone has a role to play. Get the right athletes in the right position, the right orchestra members in the right position. So typically, if you're in sales and it's a big deal, you are there with the sales role. Remember, you're the orchestra conductor on that particular day. You'll probably have a delivery, like a project manager, a program manager, a delivery person who's going to deliver the service or deliver the product, if it's a really big shipment, maybe, whose responsibility after the sale is they're going to look to your delivery person to make sure it's all on time, to budget, and all of those things. You probably want someone from customer support who's going to be looking after the relationship, maybe, after the contract has been signed. So customer support is going to be really, really important. You're probably going to have a subject matter expert. So in the context of, shall we say, a telecoms deal, you're going to have your subject matter expert, the expert on telecoms who can answer any last minute questions, who can tell them how the technology is going to work, where the risks are, and they have information, knowledge, expertise that you won't have as the salesperson. And let me tell you something, even if you do have that knowledge, they're not going to believe you. It's not nearly as believable coming from your lips as the salesperson as it is from the subject matter expert's lips, because they are paid to know that stuff. And there's no conflict of interest. Of course you're going to agree it's the best thing since sliced bread, because you're going to get a massive great commission check from doing the deal. However, the subject matter expert, if they've got any integrity at all, will be able to manage expectations and do it professionally. So that's why you have a subject matter expert there. And the last person that you're going to have there is a senior executive who are going to be there, who could make any decisions that are required, perhaps new timescales, perhaps making sure the right resources are going to be on the team, and looking the client in the eyes and committing to making the project, to making the contract a successful engagement. So there are five people. There are sales, delivery, customer support, a subject matter expert, and a senior executive. That's five people that you're going to have to that meeting with you. Now, this, don't forget, this is not at the meeting, this is the preparation. So you're going to prepare those individuals with six slides or less. If you can't get your story, your objective on six slides or less, then you're wasting your time, because these people have got other jobs to do as well. And whilst this may be your most important deal in the whole wide world, it may not be their most important deal. So you need to be able to get to an executive summary, six slides or less, in order to keep their concentration, but also, as importantly, to maximize the chances of them staying on message. They just won't be able to retain all the other information. So six slides or less. And again, learning through bitter experience, if the meeting is international, or at least a long distance away from where you normally reside or where your office normally is, make sure you travel the night before, because that's the one thing that can really hold you up is some, particularly with the times that we live in at the minute, where flights can be cancelled, where arrangements can change at a moment's notice. You've got to be on your foot. You need to be there the morning of the meeting, even if the meeting is in the afternoon, to get, because that's the most important thing that's going to happen that day. So you've got to be there. So I wonder if anyone watching this has got any examples of where they've been late for a really important meeting because the traffic was bad, because the train was cancelled, because of the list is in, the flight was cancelled. I've personally had an experience of the 0725 out of Terminal 4 Heathrow was overbooked. They wouldn't allow me on the plane. So even though I was on time, they wouldn't allow me on the plane. The plane took off. I missed the meeting, a really important meeting, and it cost me a whole load of stress. If I'd have gone out the night before, stayed at a hotel, my costs would have been increased a little bit, but the meeting would have gone a lot smoother, and we would have collapsed the timescales for doing that deal, because me not being there resulted in a delay. And lastly, the caveat, again, on preparation, is that every single meeting is different in some way, in terms of the people there, in terms of the objective, in terms of the resources available for you. So you have to think about meetings are in context. Okay, right. The meeting itself. So how you run the meeting. So you've got to imagine you've got your side of the table, and naturally people line up alongside each other, and the meeting is probably easier to manage with your colleagues sitting next to you. If you're the salesperson, you're conducting the orchestra, I encourage you, if it's a traditional conference shaped table in an oval shape or a rectangular shape, I encourage you to take a seat where all the members of your team can see you easily. So if you're five in a row and you're sat in the middle, they're not going to be able to see your cues or your encouragements or your hand signals easily. So I encourage you to take probably what's called the dominant seat at the end of the table, unless, and of course, that table is specifically reserved for their most important person. You don't want to upset or offend the client, so pick another seat where you can equally be seen, even if that means moving a chair to make sure you can be seen. That shows professionalism and expertise, and that you know what you're doing, and the client will feel encouraged, and your team will feel encouraged from you taking that leadership position. Okay, right. So you're all in the meeting, you're all, taking your seats. The next thing is to do the welcome and introductions. Now, I'm going to imagine that you've got an hour set aside for this particular meeting. So obviously, we'll assume if the meeting is at 11 o'clock on a Thursday morning, you need to be sat down in that room, ready to start the meeting at 11 o'clock. That doesn't mean turning up in reception at 11 o'clock. You'll waste your time and theirs. So give yourself every chance of succeeding. So you sat around the table on time. The next thing is welcome and introductions. Now, I always let the client go first to get them relaxed and in the meeting, get them to introduce themselves. And they may have one person. Normally the most senior person in the room will introduce their people. This is Daryl, the chief information officer. This is Jane, who's the chief technology officer, or whatever it happens to be, but they'll introduce themselves. I encourage you to introduce your people themselves. Yeah, this is Tim, who's in service delivery. This is Shana, who's in customer support. And the reason being that you should introduce your people is, I believe it's a professional courtesy, but also if you get people to introduce themselves, Sometimes, you know, particularly if they're passionate about their role, they'll take forever and they'll burn time. And that's not the point of making an introduction. You can get them to demonstrate their expertise when it comes to them contributing to the meeting. So you demonstrate through proof, and that's how they'll win hearts and minds, not in having a 3 minute long introduction, which is 5% of the meeting. Okay, so you've introduced your team, they've introduced their team. The next thing is the meeting purpose. Are we here to have the same meeting? You would not believe the number of times I've shown up to a meeting, despite how much preparation you might do. This is our objective, and it doesn't align with the objective that the client has got, because they're all busy. They don't always talk to themselves amongst themselves as much as you would like, and they've got a slightly different opinion of what's going to happen at the meeting. Something may also have changed, and so it's better to know this at the very start of the meeting, and you can adapt from there. So the meeting purpose, get lined up on what that meeting is all about. Everyone needs to agree that before you start. And also ask this one question: is there anything else? Is there anything else you would like to add to the agenda or the meeting purpose? Now, that's a very enlightening question. And you're giving them an opportunity to surface something. This is a fast-moving world that we live in. Something may have happened in the market or internally. Someone may have left, someone may have joined. This is an opportunity to surface that issue and address it and deal with it. Okay, so now that we've agreed what's going to happen at the meeting, the purpose of the meeting, the agenda, there's one more important thing before you actually formally kick it off. 1 second. And the next thing to agree is the time available for this meeting. The reason why that's important is because you may have booked it for an hour. You may be sat down at the meeting start time, ready to go. But again, it's a fast moving world. Something may have happened. Somebody really important on the other side may have to leave early. So think if that happens, if their senior executive, if their CEO or whomever it happens to be says, I'm really sorry, but I've got to leave in 20 minutes time, go straight to the issues that they care about and address them up front so that they're in the room, get their feedback. Okay, that's what you need to do. Now, just in case they all say, if they're really prepared and they're really supportive of this meeting, they will all be there for the duration of the meeting. Okay, so you've confirmed the time that the meeting is going to finish and everyone's on side. You're now ready to have your meeting and you go about setting out your business case, selling your deal, pitching your deal, if you like. And we've talked about that at many other videos, so I'm not going to concentrate on that here. The advice for how to run this meeting: are there any controversial subjects? So let's just say your client wants to pay £100 for your product. That's their price. That's the price they're willing to pay. But £100 doesn't work for you. £110, let's say, works for you, 10% more than the client's willing to pay. And you're going to need to justify that. So if that would be a controversial subject. You don't want to surface that too soon because it will be disruptive. It will make people unhappy. You want to get people lined up around the meeting, engaged in the meeting. So positive stuff. We can deliver this. We positive messages. We can support you. We are the best at doing this in the world. We're the guys and the girls, positive messages. Okay, so by the time it comes down to any controversial subject matters, margin, turnover, price that you're paying, etc., you've got people on your side supportive of your endeavors, and that gives you the maximum chance to have a what I call a grown-up conversation around that price point and your skills. And there are many other videos I've dealt with leading to negotiation. We're not going to cover that here. So now, if anyone, be it on their team or on your team, just is taking too long to cover the subject matter, or a topic comes up, a subject comes up which is off topic, it's not really important to the outcome of the meeting, you've got to take control. You've got to professionally, politely, respectfully, but robustly stop people talking about that subject. Bring them back onto your subject, talking about your number, your solution, your contract. That's important. So there's no excess baggage in that meeting. However, if a subject comes up which you just cannot settle at that meeting, you're going to need to agree a plan, a list of actions of how you are going to address that subject. Perhaps you haven't got the right people in the room. Perhaps you need an even more senior person to agree a new price and margin, whatever it happens to be, or resources. Perhaps the timescales have changed. Perhaps they want to do this, get this service started quicker than you originally envisaged. Then you might need to either go back to them and agree, or, and this is really powerful but takes a lot of courage, is ask for a brief moment to pause the meeting, go outside and make a phone call and get a commitment to those new timescales. Now, that does happen from time to time, but if you've got a senior executive in the room, this is the chance for you to look at them, and they've got to step up to the plate and they've got to approve those timescales or give a satisfactory answer, perhaps a negotiation around timescales. Okay, and then at the end of your meeting, don't forget we're only talking about the meeting here, this is not a negotiation or closing video. This is about how to run a big meeting. So at the end of the meeting, you need to take 2 minutes to wrap up, what I call wrap up, and agree the actions. And you must agree those actions in the room with those people, looking them in the eyes, and ask them, these are the actions, these are the people that are going to complete those actions. And it's your responsibility as the salesperson of record on the day to agree those actions. So it's a really responsible role. And some of their people will be responsible for certain actions. You need to agree, get their commitment to those actions and when they're going to do them by. And your people as well in the room, you're going to need to agree those actions with them up front while everyone's in the room. You'll then follow up afterwards with an email confirming them. But the important thing is you've already agreed it at the meeting, because the worst thing that can happen is that you've had your tea and biscuits, you shake hands, if that's what you do in that your part of the world, you walk away, you follow up with an email that says, according to me, these are the actions. And then they either don't come back to you, or they come back and say, well, we didn't agree to that. That's why you absolutely need to agree. This is what's happening, and this is when it's happening, and this is who's doing those actions. Okay, right, we've labored that one, but it's a really important point. So, 1 second. So that's what's happening at the meeting. These are some common mistakes. Common mistakes are that I've observed both firsthand because I've made them, or been on the receiving end of common mistakes in supplier meetings that I've had where we're looking to award business, is failure to brief, where their side or your side, let's assume it's your side, have failed to brief all the meeting participants properly. They're not really lined up. And one of your key people, and don't forget, they're key people because they're in the room. And if they're not key people, they shouldn't be in the room with you. The key person is off message or fails to successfully land the right message in the right way with the right person. And that's almost always due to lack of preparation, and it's your responsibility to prepare those people. Another common mistake is that you're gonna let the lawyers sort it out. And this is no disrespect to lawyers. A lawyer's job is to protect their company and to know the law in that order. Let the lawyers sort it out. So a personal example is when I was negotiating, or I was involved in a deal in New York with my company and a large US investment bank. And I had a lawyer on the ground in New York City, and I was based in London, and I thought, I'm not going to go to that. I'm going to trust this person who I knew pretty well to go to that meeting and negotiate it on my behalf. Excuse me. And their meeting was due to take place 11 o'clock local time. And I got a phone call at 12:30, which from this person who I presumed was going to give me an update on how it had been a wonderful meeting. So she phoned me back at 12:30. I picked up the phone and she said, I'm still in the meeting and we're still stuck on clause number one. We cannot agree definition. And I thought, oh my goodness, we're an hour and a half. We're not even past definition, which is just, you know, and there are 39 other points to negotiate. So mine, and it was my mistake, not their mistake, my mistake was in not being in the room at the time to, you know, persuade everyone, look, you know, let's be reasonable. And sometimes lawyers look to the salesperson for guidance in what's an acceptable risk, what's not an acceptable risk. And don't forget, and again, no disrespect to lawyers, a lawyer's role is to advise, not dictate. Okay, so let the lawyers sort it out. Don't do that. Be there in the meeting. If the meeting is important, you want the deal to go ahead. The other mistake that can happen, and particularly with powerful personalities, is you get what I call the compulsive contributor, somebody who often happens with senior people, with dominant people. They just can't stop talking about, and they take over the meeting. And now if the meeting's going in the right way and it's ticking all the boxes and you're getting what you need from the meeting, that may be okay. But if it's not, if they're just talking about stuff which isn't really relevant, it's not really taking you forward to achieve your objective, I beg your pardon, then you've got to find a way. And again, he may be your line manager or she may be your line manager. So you've got to do this respectfully, but firmly. Is get them to withdraw, take control of the conversation. And there might be, to use a previous video we've had on this program, there might be a high I or a high D, to use the DISC profiling mechanism tool that we've talked about in previous videos. There might be a high I or a high D. You've got to find a way to calm them down, stop them talking. You then take over the meeting and get the meeting back on track. That's part of your conducting the orchestra role. The other mistake, fourth mistake, there's one more after this. Fourth mistake is allowing the discussion to meander. It's going all over the place. We're talking about this subject and that subject, however fascinating it may be. If it's not taking you towards your objective and it's not important to the meeting, you've got to stop. You've got to control the meeting. So here's another case study. I was in a meeting with a really big US telecoms company a while back, where we had the regional CEO, the CEO for Europe, Middle East and Africa, in the room with one of his other people and four of us. Again, sales, subject matter expert, senior executive. And this guy, their CEO, loved to talk generally about themselves. Again, another high I, according to that DISC profiling. And you, We were all over the place. Now, I thought I was doing the right thing and allowing them to talk, because that's what we're always told. Let the client talk. But the thing is, they were doing two things. They weren't really talking about what we wanted them to talk about, which was our deal or the deal that they wanted to do. And they were burning time. So after an hour and a half, we'd run out of time. We'd not achieved our objectives because I allowed them to talk too much, and that was my responsibility. And they talked about lots of stuff. So we learned a bit, but it wasn't the right kind of information that we needed. So that was a big mistake. Don't make that mistake. And also, the fifth final mistake, there are going to be plenty more, but the ones I want to talk about in this video, is where you take the wrong people. So sometimes you can just select the wrong delivery person, the wrong customer sales person, and it can be or the wrong executive, and it can be perhaps a lack of skills or relevant experience. It might be a particular business sector experience. Maybe they haven't got as much telecoms or financial services experience as perhaps the client would like them to have. There might be a personality conflict. If they're both high D's, they might be bashing heads like that, and it prevents the meeting from progressing because they're just at each other's throats. Again, that's where your skill as a salesperson, as a professional, comes into a clear focus, is if you fail to spot that might happen in advance, and when it's happening in front of you in the meeting, from your failure to take control of those circumstances, get them to withdraw, get the meeting back on track and focused on the things that you need to get the outcome that your company wants. Okay, right. So we're coming to the end now, and I think we're roughly on time. I'm just going to sum up now the big learning moments, if you like, from big meetings. Is number one is, if you fail to prepare, you prepare to fail. Where have we heard that before? So full preparation with all the people, and make sure you brief all the attendees so that you have clarity, so that you have alignment. And if someone can't or won't attend your briefing, ask yourself, do you really want them there? Do you really need them there at this client meeting? Because preparedness is important, and lack of preparedness can absolutely undo all the good that you've previously done. So think about that really, really clearly. Now, if it's a senior executive, they're going to be short of time. So you may have to brief them, even if it's in reception, waiting for the client to come downstairs. Even if it's a video call, you take 2 minutes for a cup of tea before the meeting to get them, to remind them to be on side at the meeting. Okay, next thing is, you're gonna need a continuous review throughout that meeting, a sort of sense check. Are we on track? Are we achieving what we need to achieve? Are there any negative signs coming from the client? How do I address those? Do I need to address those? So it's a continuous review of what's happening in that meeting. The next thing is what I call an agreement staircase. We've talked about those before. An agreement staircase is when you're literally building an agreement. You're building what I call rapport between the various parties at the meeting. I beg your pardon, generally only two, to you and your client. They may have an outside law firm, but for all intents and purposes, it's one party. So an agreement staircase, where you get an agreement with everything else before you come to that controversial subject, be it profitability, be it time scales, be it resources, whatever it happens to be. Before you get to the really sticky subject matters, you've already got rapport, trust, that famous word, which we all need to build before we get to those sticky moments, okay? And then the last 5 minutes, or last 2 minutes, probably, for a 1 hour meeting is take those 2 minutes and do a formal wrap up and close, list the actions, the people responsible, and the timescales for delivering on those actions at the meeting. So that if there are any disagreements at all, you've uncovered them and addressed them at the meeting. And lastly, remember what Sartre said, which is hell is other people. There's nothing harder control than other people in your meeting. If it's not on your team, it'll be with the other side, the client, the prospect, whatever it is. Nobody said it was easy. And that's why as salespeople, you get paid the big bucks because you've got to manage and execute and get the right answer for you and your company, which hopefully chimes with them and their company. Okay, brilliant. Right, now I've come to the end. I just want you to take 30 seconds now, and I want to ask you a couple of quick questions. As a result of watching this video, what one thing has stood out for you? I'd love to know your comment on this one. What one thing has stood out for you? What's really resonated with you? You think, oh yeah, okay, I really get that. And then I'd like you to ask yourself, what one thing are you going to start doing as a result of having watched this video? And what one thing are you going to stop doing as a result of watching this video? Okay, so thank you for watching. I'm going to be doing another video in a couple of weeks on managing conflict, which will be really interesting. I'm doing that again with Nigel Smith. You can follow me on Sales Marvel or on Eventbrite and get to find out about all these webinars that are coming up. And lastly, it is going to be thank you so much for watching up until now. Please let me know your feedback. Please let me know if there are any subjects you want me to talk about. This has been a real pleasure delivering this and putting some thought into what makes a successful meeting. I hope you've enjoyed it too. And thank you for watching. And I hope to speak with you really, really soon. Take care.